who we are and where we've come from and what the fate of our universe has been, the universe that we belong to, are eternal questions that have plagued human beings. The ancients looked up into the sky and were mesmerized, and they ended up attributing gods and goddesses to what they saw as periodic phenomena on the sky. My own personal love affair with the cosmos started when I was a girl in Delhi, and I looked through a telescope at Halley's Comet. It was one of those flybys of Halley's Comet when I was growing up. I looked through a telescope, and that was it. I was hooked. And from then on, I've become one of these cosmic explorers, people who are looking to understand and make sense of the grandest things in the universe that luckily, given who we are and where we are technologically and scientifically, are actually comprehensible. And that's what is incredible, that it's comprehensible. So what you see here are some of the deepest images of the night sky taken by the Hubble Space Telescope. Every little speck that you see there is a distant galaxy. And light from many of these galaxies left them about several billion years ago. So we're actually seeing a photograph of the younger universe. So when you look out into the night sky, you're looking back in time. So this is really no different from archaeology when you dig underground and find artifacts. So this is basically archaeology of the cosmos. When you look out into the night sky, you are actually seeing the history of all the stars that have formed in all the galaxies out there. And it turns out that our cosmic messenger is really light. It is light that carries all the information about what's out there, and it's light that we analyze, it's the properties of light that we use to make sense of the universe. Now, digging on Earth, right, sort of the archaeology on Earth, has turned up some amazing artifacts. So, for example, from the Harappan civilization, we see these figurines of goddesses. And what you see there is my personal favorite, which is a cuneiform tablet from about 4,000 years ago, where the Mesopotamians recorded the positions of the planet Venus. They didn't know that they had to look for causes. They were just noting periodicities. There was this obsession with patterns, these celestial patterns. Although at the time, there was no science, there was no explanation, but they were recordings. But you can learn a lot. We learned a lot from these artifacts that the Sumerians left. We know about the cuneiform script. We knew that the Harappans were great urban planners, for example. We know they were an agrarian society. Similarly, we found fossils. So we found this fossil that you see there is of the Iceman. From the contents of his stomach, from the DNA analysis, we've been able to figure out that he came from an agrarian society. So the kinds of things you can learn looking at artifacts that you've dug out on Earth are incredible. So we can do the same thing with the cosmos. So I would like to take you on a little journey to show you what the cosmic dig has turned up. The cosmic dig has actually turned up a very peculiar universe. Our notion of the universe has been radically disrupted. But then this is science, right? Science is disruptive by nature. Nothing is fixed. Everything is provisional. It is the current best understanding that you have. So the current picture that we have of our universe is one of a very bizarre universe. It's a universe in which the stuff that we're made of, ordinary atoms, are a measly 4%. And the bulk of the contents of the universe are these unknown, mysterious quantities called dark matter and dark energy. So most of the matter in the universe is dark matter. It doesn't emit any light. It does not emit any radiation, either in the X-ray visible or any wavelength. The only way we know that there is dark matter is from the gravity that it exerts. So right now, the cosmic dig has turned up an understanding of how our cosmos came to be. And that's what you see in that little cartoon there. We started from a very early hot Big Bang. The universe expanded and galaxies formed, leading up to the present day. These disruptive discoveries have been phenomenal, right? So till 1900, we thought that there was only one galaxy. Well, of course, in 1500, Copernicus moved the pivot from the Earth to the Sun. So that was pretty disruptive. But after that, we thought there was only one galaxy. So the Milky Way was alone, stagnant. It was the only thing in town. It turns out in 1915, astronomers finally figured out that there were many other external galaxies. That was pretty radical. Then in 1929, something even more radical happened. Edwin Hubble figured out that the universe was not static. It was actually expanding. And that was pretty mind-blowing. That was pretty disorienting. But what we have now found in the last 10 to 15 years is not only that the universe is expanding, but it's accelerating. The expansion is accelerating. So this is pretty disorienting, and this is pretty disturbing in terms of a fundamental shift in how we conceptualize the universe. Before I move on, I just want to alert you to the fact that one question everybody has is the universe finite or is it infinite? So it turns out that only a finite portion of the universe is always visible to us. There's only a portion that we can see that is constrained by the speed of light. Whether there's a universe beyond that, we don't know. We'll have to wait a billion years, and then we can see a little further. So one of the disruptive elements that has fundamentally transformed our understanding of the universe is this notion that Einstein came up with in his theory of general relativity that's celebrating the 100th year this year, is that the contents, the geometry, and the fate of the universe are interlinked. He was audacious. He actually managed to write an equation in which, on the right-hand side, on the left-hand side, he modeled properties of the entire universe. Okay, so, and he figured out that what the universe is made of and what the fate of the universe, whether it's expanding or it's not, and the shape of space are intricately linked. Aside from that, he made another very, very profound discovery about the nature of gravity, and I'll just get to that. You may have all seen sort of this demotion of Pluto, so let's forget about that. As far as I'm concerned, Pluto's still a planet. And so if you look at the solar system, right, so sun's gravity dominates, and you see the speeds of planets around the sun, and they're falling. So Mercury's moving the fastest, and Pluto's moving the slowest. And what this really tells you is the majority of the gravity is provided by the sun that's at the center, which is why as it falls out, you're going further away from the body that's most massive. So when you do the same exercise for a galaxy and you map the speeds of stars from the center outward, you find something completely bizarre. You find something pretty inexplicable. It doesn't look anything like the solar system. What it looks like is that there's a lot of matter, gravitating matter at the outskirts that is holding up the galaxy, but we don't see it. The stars that we see in the galaxy are insufficient to provide the kind of gravity that you infer from the speeds at the outskirts. And this was the first clue that we had, astronomers had, for dark matter, for the evidence. This is evidence for dark matter, where you don't see it directly, but you see the gravitational influence that it exerts. And this was actually discovered and rediscovered many times from the 1970s through the 80s. It was such a bizarre claim that the astronomers who first discovered it stayed quiet for about 5 years. They just didn't publish their results because it was too controversial. But eventually, many lines of independent evidence aligned. Everybody who made independent measurements found these results. And finally, the concept of dark matter was accepted. So this is the current conception of a galaxy, every galaxy, including our own. Stars constitute a very, very small portion. The inner portion is the tip of the iceberg that we see. The bulk of the galaxy remains unseen. And we know that because the stuff that's outside the dark matter exerts gravitational influence. So the other radical disruption that Einstein came up with was a reconceptualizing of space and time. So he came up with this entity called space-time, which is really a sheet. It's a four-dimensional sheet. And he found that he reformulated Newton's gravity. So basically, there's a different way to think, a new way to think about mass and space-time. So basically, mass causes potholes in the fabric of space-time, like you see here. This is a cartoon version of the bump, the pothole in space-time shown as a grid that the sun causes. And so space, the shape of space, is determined by mass. So gravity and shape of space are intricately related, and you can see that already. This has very interesting consequences. A little pothole is created by something that's not so massive. If a body, a celestial body, is very, very massive, for example, if it's a neutron star, which is very tightly packed, then you have a bigger bump, you have a bigger pothole. You have a lot of clumpy things, you have a lot of little pothole, rather like, you know, the potholes on the street. But what is really bizarre are, of course, these objects, black holes, that not only generate a pothole, but they actually create a pinch in space-time. So, but this is what happens to space-time when you have mass. And what's interesting about it is this: these potholes in space-time. Remember, everything in the universe lives on space-time. There's nothing above it, there's nothing below it, right? So we're all in there. So light has to travel on space-time. So it turns out that the potholes cause deviations in the path of light. So you end up seeing stars where they aren't really there. You see displaced positions for stars. Not only do you see displaced positions, so what is shown here is, if you can think of light as a tube, what you see there are those tubes. And here, I've not exaggerated the potholes. They are gentler potholes, and you can see these deviations in how light travels to us. So one of the consequences of that is, when light from a distant galaxy, like in the first image I showed you, reach us, we no longer see the real shape of those galaxies. They're distorted. They're distorted by all the lumps and bumps that the light has encountered on its way to us. So essentially, when you're looking out into the universe, we are looking at shapes of galaxies that are highly deformed, but they are deformed in a very systematic way. And they're deformed and stretched out in arc-like shapes. And so this is called gravitational lensing. And it turns out that the amount of mass that you need to cause this level of distortion, this amount of stretching, is not enough. It's not enough if you just count up the mass in the stars. You need dark matter. So this is the other way in which we have inferred the presence of dark matter in the universe. So what you see here is a normal fuzzy high redshift galaxy, that little fuzzy thing, and there is a galaxy with light and a dark matter halo that you don't see that causes its shape to be mangled like this, and this is what you end up seeing. Okay, so that's the original shape. So this is another rendition of that, which shows, again, space-time and a big pothole now, and light rays and light paths from distant objects that come towards us that get bent in a lot of different ways. And we actually see those effects. You can see here already the many arcs and distortions. You can see these distortions. You can see these bent out of shapes. So basically, looking at this image now, we know there's a lot of dark matter in here, which we don't see. Not only do we see objects not where they are, stretched out, occasionally, if things line up just right, it's like an optical lens, really, you can see multiple copies of the same object, like in this Hubble Space Telescope image. So you're seeing five copies of the same galaxy, and they are marked as A, B, C, D, and E. And how do we know it's the same galaxy? You know, galaxies like us have fingerprints, they have spectra, and these have identical spectra. So there is no way that these could have been randomly situated galaxies that happen to look identical. So what we end up seeing in the universe are these effects of dark matter, these indirect effects of dark matter. And the reason this is puzzling is that we know a lot about dark matter now, the kinds of effects that it causes, but we don't know what it is. We don't know what particle it is. The only thing we know is that it formed very likely very, very early in the universe. So what do people like me do? Astrophysicists like me, I'm a cosmologist, I'm just a cosmic optometrist. I am actually calibrating these lenses, these regions in the universe that have a huge amount of dark matter that we see through. Through them, we see the distant universe. They bring the distant universe into focus. And these are nature's telescopes. These are telescopes bigger than anything we can ever, ever build. Okay, and it's serendipity that they're there. Many people like me calibrate these lenses, and we're able to figure out what the distribution of dark matter looks like. So dark matter is smeared everywhere in the universe. There's some in this room, but it's very sparse. But it's piled in many regions in space. And so what we recover, what you see here, is the distribution of dark matter, how it's piled up. So in fact, this is how it is. What you end up seeing in a Hubble Space Telescope image, that optical image, is no dark matter, just the light. And after reconstructing the dark matter distribution from those distorted shapes, you end up seeing that blue fuzz. You don't see it, but we recreate the distribution of dark matter, which is shown as the blue fuzz there. So here's what the cosmic dig has revealed, right? It has disrupted all our earlier notions of the cosmos. And so today, this is what we know. This is the map, the cosmic map, that the cosmic archaeological dig has turned up to date. This is, of course, subject to change. So what we know is that there was a hot Big Bang, and after that, you formed the first galaxies, the first stars. And now we know that there are many stars that have many planetary systems like our own strewn around even just our galaxy. And likely around every galaxy in the universe, you probably have a lot of planets. You probably have more planets than you have stars in the universe. That's our current understanding. And we also know in our own solar system, very recently, we discovered water on Mars. So we might be an aberration, right? Intelligent life on this pale blue dot, we might be an aberration, or there may be life forms. What is clear is that although we appear to be somewhat random and perhaps insignificant, we're not. We're very significant. We are very significant because to this day, we are the only civilization that has had the capacity to comprehend the universe. So life on this tiny pale blue dot, although we are small in the grand scheme of things, it's human curiosity that has led us to dig and helps us dig even further and further back into the past. So who knows what disruptive discoveries lie ahead? Thank you.